In this, the last chapter of the text, we will focus on EMS provider health and wellness. When completed with this module, you should be able to identify and analyze the major causes involved in line of duty deaths related to health, wellness, fitness, and vehicle operations. Identify and assess safety needs for both emergency and non-emergency situations. Describe the benefits of risk management and safety programs, and identify the role of EMS personnel in risk management and safety. The introductory scenario in this chapter assumes that most of your personnel want a physical fitness program to be established within the organization. It is your task to develop the program and also make recommendations on how to implement it. Are there any specific components you need to consider? Who or what are some resources you can access to develop the program? Is there anyone within the organization who should be involved in this initiative? These are all some very important questions to ask on the front end of developing a physical fitness program. As far as the health and wellness of EMS providers is concerned, there is not much research available on the subject. Despite this lack of research, this is a critical topic for any EMS leader, as your agency's most valuable resource is its employees. As a leader and manager within an EMS organization, you have a legal, ethical, and moral duty to provide for the safety, health, and well-being of your employees. Due to the relationship between the professions, some emerging research on firefighter and law enforcement officers' safety, health, and well-being may assist in the exploration of this topic. Unfortunately, protective service professions do not lend themselves to a great deal of inherent safety and wellness. EMS as a profession is inherently risky. Providers are routinely exposed to hazardous conditions on a regular basis, not the least of which being routine and close contact with sick people. Some pervasive risk factors within the profession include a systemic lack of physical fitness, lack of pre-employment physical ability testing, occupational exposure to various diseases and unsafe environments, use of medications with various side effects, use of tobacco and alcohol, hearing loss, back injuries, and even cancer. EMS providers are also at a higher risk for social issues, such as withdrawal from others, even family members, dependency, which includes medication, alcohol, and possibly illegal substances, and suicide. These risk factors are compounded by chaotic and unpredictable schedules, repetitive trauma or motion injuries, often related to the lifting and transporting of patients, routine lack of adequate sleep, and emotional trauma and fatigue, including post-traumatic stress, Metalis syndrome, and other psychological ailments that may manifest themselves during an EMS career. The textbook explores these risk factors in greater depth, and you are encouraged to research these subjects yourself as well. To combat these risk factors, EMS agencies are encouraged to review NFPA 1500, the Standard on Fire Department Occupational Safety and Health Programs, and focus on five main areas of prevention and help. First, every wellness program should include annual and periodic medical evaluations for your EMS providers. NFPA 1582, the Standard on Comprehensive Occupational Medical Programs for Fire Departments, provides a good outline of what such a program should entail. And the textbook includes a list of tests, examinations, and information that should be part of such a program. Infection control activities are also critical for EMS providers, more so than they are for other emergency workers, given routine exposure of EMS providers to sick and unhealthy patients. While OSHA requires healthcare workers to be provided hepatitis B vaccinations at the employer's expense, there are other vaccinations that every EMS provider should receive, such as measles, mumps, and rubella, varicella, tetanus and diphtheria, and an annual influenza vaccine. Emotional support is also critical for EMS providers, and EMS agencies should have a comprehensive employee assistance program in place to assist members with not only coping with the rigors and emotional pitfalls of the job, but also other life issues that may not necessarily be directly related to the job, such as legal advice, financial planning or concerns, and other personal matters. Your employees have a life outside of their employment, and their emotional wellness is the totality of their whole person, which means you must care for the entire provider. Your concern for your employees cannot be limited to when they are on shift. Rather, a comprehensive EAP should be available to assist at all hours. These programs also are designed to assist with alcohol and substance abuse, as well as psychological health and suicide prevention. Having an EAP also ties into other stress and mental health initiatives. The cumulative stress of the job can take a toll. Sometimes there is a significant precipitating incident. Other times, the problems manifest themselves slowly over time. With that being said, timing is not necessarily a critical factor, as problems can arise after a 20-year career or within the first week on the job. It is sometimes easy to see when a provider is in a bad physical state, given easily observable clues like weight, exertion, breathing, and other physiological elements. Emotional health, on the other hand, is not always so easy to determine or interpret, yet it is just as important. Critical incident stress management or debriefings, for instance, are just one way in which EMS agencies are trying to help their providers cope with the stresses of the job, especially after a significant or crucial incident. For reference, high work stress burnout consists of three components: emotional exhaustion that may lead to negative, cynical attitude toward patients, de-individualization and depersonalization of patients, and a tendency for providers to evaluate themselves negatively when assessing their work with patients. These behaviors are all outward signs of a provider who may be emotionally unhealthy, and they should be taken seriously. Having an effective fitness program is important for the health and well-being of your EMS providers, as is a policy for incident rehabilitation and a procedure to help injured EMS providers return to work after an injury. We will explore these remaining subjects independently in the upcoming slides. Physical fitness and health is critical for EMS providers. A lack of proper nutrition and exercise, along with being overweight or obese, can be significant contributing factors to heart disease, diabetes, high blood pressure, back injuries, and a myriad of other health problems. Aside from the safety and health implications for your employees, unhealthy providers are also less effective at their jobs, which will have an impact on patient care. One of the first components of an effective physical fitness program is a comprehensive medical screening. This screening establishes a baseline for the provider against which a trending analysis can be performed at subsequent screenings. With medical screening completed, a fitness assessment should then be performed to evaluate the provider's cardiovascular capacity, muscular strength, muscular endurance, and flexibility. If you have a college or university nearby with a physical education, physical therapy, or other related program, you may be able to partner with them to have these assessments conducted for free. Some fitness-related businesses or gyms may also be able to provide these services. At some point while establishing your physical fitness program, your organization should also establish the fitness standards it will use to ensure the program is related to the profession. For instance, cardio training without any resistance or weight training is probably not appropriate for an EMS provider who will be lifting and moving patients. With these preliminary steps completed, it is then time to develop the exercise program for your personnel. A comprehensive program should include activities that work on cardiac conditioning and endurance, strength and resistance training, flexibility, balance, and even meditation exercises. Partnering with a local gym, school, YMCA, or other organization may be a good solution for your service if you are unable to purchase the exercise equipment or free up the facility space necessary to support the program. Lastly, it has been said that you cannot exercise yourself out of a bad diet. Exercise is important, but so too is nutrition. EMS is notorious for unhealthy eating and food choices. Eating fast food while sitting in the ambulance on a regular basis is not a model for long-term sustainable health. Exercising 30 minutes a day will do little to stop an expanding waistline if a provider is consuming over 3,000 calories a day. What we drink can have a significant impact on our health as well. Soda, for instance, is loaded with sugar. Coffee has caffeine, which can negatively impact the body in other ways. Working with a local dietitian or nutritionist would be extraordinarily beneficial in helping your riders eat healthy while on or off duty. Any wellness program you develop must address both physical fitness and nutrition, as one without the other diminishes the value of the program. Even off-duty injury prevention is important. Encouraging the use of bicycle helmets and seatbelts, for instance, is not just something we tell the public, but something we must encourage within our own ranks. Incident rehabilitation is another wellness program facet that must be considered at major incidents and training events. NFPA 1584 is the standard on the rehabilitation process for members during emergency operations and training exercises, and such a rehabilitation process begins with the incident commander, who must assess every incident for the need to ensure emergency personnel are adequately rested and rehabilitated as necessary to not only sustain ongoing incident operations, but to maximize emergency workers' safety and wellness while functioning at an incident. This responsibility also extends down through the incident command structure to supervisors and even the personnel themselves. The need to establish incident rehabilitation, whether broadly for the entire incident or even on an individual basis where a provider ensures he or she remains hydrated or protected from the elements, is important. If a provider is feeling fatigued or unwell while functioning at an incident, that provider must notify his or her supervisor. Inversely, supervisors must keep their eyes open for signs of fatigue, heat exhaustion, or environmental exposure. The incident commander must ensure the location for any rehabilitation activities is appropriate given the circumstances. If it is a hot, humid day, the location should be someplace where air conditioning is available, such as a building, an ambulance, or maybe even an air-conditioned bus or fire truck. If apparatus are functioning on the scene, the rehabilitation area should not be located where providers are breathing exhaust from the vehicles. The location should also be readily accessible by the personnel. On larger incidents, the incident command structure should contain a rehabilitation sector or group to handle the logistics and other facets of ensuring personnel are adequately evaluated and rehabilitated before they return to action. One tool for a rehabilitation officer includes NOAA's heat index chart, which provides a quick overview of how ambient air temperature and relative humidity contribute to heat disorders with prolonged exposure or strenuous activity. Being in Wisconsin, we are also very familiar with the National Weather Service's wind chill readings. As the temperature drops and the wind speed increases, exposed skin is more likely to suffer from frostbite in shorter periods of time. As far as rehab is concerned, it is important to consider proper hydration, nourishment, rest, and recovery. A medical evaluation should be performed on each provider in rehab to assess overall well-being by monitoring vital signs. Ultimately, rehab also plays a part in incident accountability. Personnel routed to rehab should check in and check out of rehab. If assigned as a crew, the crew integrity should be maintained while they're in rehab. Individuals who are not ready to return to work should not be released from rehab, and if the provider's condition is severe enough, it may be necessary to transport the provider to the hospital for additional care. While no EMS agency wants one of its providers to suffer an injury, given the hazardous nature of EMS, injuries can be a likely occurrence. With this in mind, every agency should have a return-to-work program in place to ensure the integrity of care provided by the agency while also protecting the provider from additional complications or injuries. Lost-time injuries are expensive, and employers have a vested interest in seeing injured employees return to the job as soon as realistically possible. For injured employees, such a program is beneficial as well in that data shows improved morale and comfort in knowing that the employer cares about the injured employee. Ultimately, an injured employee has the opportunity to remain active and retains a sense of value. The organization, on the other hand, not only benefits by retention of a valuable and trained employee, but there may be financial benefits in terms of lower workers' compensation premiums and related medical expenses. In developing a return-to-work program, there are several components that must be included. The first is support from higher levels of management. The organization itself must believe in the importance of a return-to-work program. This also means that the program applies to all employees, not just those in favor with management. An entity or team must have ultimate responsibility for the management of the program. If a team is used, it should meet to develop and formalize the program, and then meet weekly whenever a lost time claim occurs. There should be clear guidelines that outline how injuries are reported, and personnel should be trained on the procedure. Work with the employee's treating physician or medical provider to establish a reasonable return to work target date. As not all medical providers are familiar with the field of EMS, it is important to ensure the medical provider is familiar with the injured party's routine duties and functional job tasks. Providing a job description, including the physical requirements and working conditions, to the medical provider can prove beneficial. Many employers also include an early return to work program within the overall program. Oftentimes referred to as light duty or transitional employment, an early return to work program provides short-term duties within a specified time frame for personnel who have been injured and cannot return to their time of injury duties. Transitional employment includes only short-term duties that require limited physical ability requirements, can be taught to the injured employee quickly, can be done within a flexible work schedule, and would minimize exposure of the injured worker to further injury and would not slow down recovery time. Transitional employment programs provide additional benefits for the employee and employer by providing a mechanism for the employee to participate in meaningful work for the organization while he or she is still not fully recovered to the point where providing emergency medical care in the field is prudent. Based on the limitations defined by the medical provider, it may be possible to modify the individual's existing job. This could include a reduction in hours or providing time for the employee to obtain treatment or therapy. Depending on the duties performed, it may be prudent to reduce the employee's wage, keeping in mind that workers' compensation should pay the difference between the pre-injury wage and the temporary wage, not to exceed the temporary total disability rate for the injury. Once the individual returns to full duty, provide some routine follow-up to ensure there are no lingering problems for the employee that would require any additional modifications to his or her assigned work. As this process deals with the employee's personal medical information, confidentiality requirements must be addressed within the program. All information collected from medical examinations or inquiries must be treated as confidential records, meaning they are collected and maintained on separate forms in separate files as required by the organization's record-keeping policy. The goal is to eventually return the injured employee to a pre-injury state if possible. Given the unique nature of each individual circumstance and injury, employers must maintain an open mind and remain flexible. With that being said, there can be complications that arise in a return-to-work program, such as poorly performing individuals, employees facing termination due to a reduction in the workforce, short-term employees, substance abusing individuals, and employees nearing retirement age. Any one of these people could refuse to take a modified job, or you, as the employer, may not have any appropriate work available for the individual. Even in light of these complications, flexibility is key, along with a strong organizational commitment to the program. Keep in mind that there are many components within a return-to-work program, which means involvement of numerous personnel, from managers and safety coordinators to third-party medical providers and workers' compensation representatives. An effective return-to-work program recognizes the importance of cooperation with and coordination between various parties and entities. In the end, having a set procedure with specific steps will help ensure all employees are treated consistently and fairly within the process. Making something up as you go is a recipe for disaster. The development of a thorough return-to-work program should occur well before an injury happens within the workplace. To revisit the earlier scenario, it may not be a bad idea to find a company that specializes in medical screening for emergency service personnel and ask them to perform a medical evaluation for all personnel. While that is occurring, you could also work with a local educational institution or business to provide a fitness trainer with expertise in developing exercise programs that can be adapted to your workforce. If you can find a local dietitian or nutritionist to provide education and training for your providers, that will help round out your physical fitness program. With your completion of this module, you should now be able to describe at least 3 high-risk factors for EMS personnel, identify 5 areas that EMS organizations should focus on to build a strong wellness program, recommend components of an annual medical evaluation program, list recommended vaccinations for EMS personnel, explain the major components of an employee assistance program, describe the components of an effective fitness program, explain what is entailed in validating a physical ability test, describe the thought process for determining the best site for a rehabilitation site at an operational incident, describe the benefits of an early return-to-work program, and list the tips recommended by the Canada Mental Health Association for dealing with stress.